as we mentioned, this is a third in a series about how do we find out God's assignment for the rest of our life? What on earth am I here for? How do we know that we finished the race that he called us to run? One thing we said about our knowing our purpose or assignment is we can't just make it up. We believe that we were created and designed by God for a specific purpose. That before you were born, he decided what the plan for your life is. And the only way that you're going to know it is to ask the designer, you know, to go to the manufacturer's handbook and say, what am I for? And he'll show us. And so that's what we're doing. And we're looking today at the first of the five main purposes the Bible says that you're here for. And this is a very important one because this fulfilling this purpose makes fulfilling the other purposes in your life possible. And this purpose is what I call becoming best friends with God. It's learning to let God love us so that we can love him back and we can enjoy a personal fellowship with him. Jesus, at the end of his ministry, explained, you see, in the beginning, Adam and Eve were created for this fellowship. And in the Garden of Eden, they had this amazing relationship. And God walked with them. Everything they did came out of that relationship. They named the animals. They got along with each other because they had the glory of that relationship. And yet they fell away when they sinned and that relationship was broken. And the whole rest of the Bible talks about how God had to get a plan that Jesus could come and die for us to win us back into that relationship. That's why he came. And Jesus explained it in this beautiful way in John chapter 15, if we could read this, John 15, 13. He says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends. Can you say, I'm God's friend? That's pretty impressive. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants because a servant doesn't know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go forth and bring fruit, fruit that will last. And whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Jesus said, everything I've done is so that we can not just be servants. Did you know what? God doesn't want you to be his employee. He doesn't want you to be his citizen. He doesn't want you to be his slave. He wants you to be his friend. And the word friend there is a very powerful original language. It means, it's the word they used for a best man. I want you to be a covenant friend of mine, like my best man. If you go through the Bible and see the secret of every person who changed the world, you'll read about how they had a friendship with God. The Bible says Abraham was God's friend. The Bible says Moses talked to God face to face like a friend talks to a friend. And it was out of that friendship that they were able to change the world. Someone said, God doesn't have favorites, but he does have intimates. What does that mean? He has people who take the time to get to know him. And those who do, he uses, he blesses, he favors. The only people who will change the world for God are those who live feeling the smile of God on them, the power of God because of their deep-rooted relationship. Now, the amazing thing is that the way we get that relationship is very simple. We learn how to let God love us. Did you know the number one purpose of your life is to let God love you? Because when you love, he loves you, let him love you, you'll love him back. And then everything you're supposed to be will come out of that. See, God did not create you to do something for him. Number one, he created you to receive something from him. And that's a relationship. Right? Christianity is not a religion. It's a what? A relationship. It's not about a bunch of things you have to do so you can go to heaven. It's about God choosing you and loving you in a way that so changes you that you want to live for him. I love this verse in Revelation 4:11. It says, God, you created all things, and it was for your pleasure that they are created. Did you know why you exist? Because you exist for God's pleasure. You exist because God delights in you. God loves having you. He wanted a family. That's why you're here. And the day you were born, he was smiling ear to ear. He delights in you. I remember as a dad, when my kids were babies, sometimes I would just watch them play and I would just feel pleasure, especially when they were sleeping. How many know that's the easiest time? And you kind of watch their little chest go up and down. Sometimes I would even cry. As I said, that is so amazing. That's my baby girl. That's my little boy. And God feels that. The Bible says in Exodus 34:18, he is a God who is passionate about his relationship with you. God's passionate about you. What is he passionate about? He's passionate to have a relationship, to love you and to have you love him back. Hosea 6:6 says, I don't want your sacrifice. I don't want you to be religious. I want your love. I don't want your offerings. I want you to know me. I want you to have a relationship with me as an intimate friend. It is from that relationship, as I said, that we're able to do the things God wants us to do. Guilt can't empower you to fulfill the purpose of God in your life. Duty won't do it. Determination won't do it. Only love. The Bible says the love of Christ motivates us. I saw this change, you know, when I remember was in middle school, about 7th, 8th grade, and I really was a poor student. Spent a lot of time in the principal's office. I just didn't like school. Got to know the Board of Education, the whole thing. But I had a teacher named Miss Hasty, and one day I was doing something stupid in her class. I think I had made darts. I was throwing them at people. I don't know. She had me after, and I was ready for the whole scoop. And she looked me in the eye, and she said, I refuse to believe that that behavior reflects who you really are. And she told me, I know you're a natural born leader. And I know that you're in my class because I'm supposed to help you. And she said, I just think you're incredible. And it just kind of blew me away. Did you know from that day on, I became a better student? I saw myself in Miss Hasty's eyes as different than what I thought I was. And I wanted to live in a different way. The moment you see your value in God's eyes, you will change completely. And you'll start to live a life at another level. Only to the degree you see your value in God will you have victory in God. I love the verse in Romans 5:17. It says that the person who receives the abundance of God's grace and the gift of righteousness will win in life. It doesn't say the person who tries hard, who's smartest. It says the person who knows how to receive the most, who knows how to let God love them. They will win in life. There's a book in the Bible called Jude, and anybody know where the book of Jude is? It's in the back. I told them the last service, you ought to read the book of Jude. It's awesome. Plus, when you get to heaven, Jude may come up to you and say, hey, how'd you like my book? And you don't want to be embarrassed. You want to say, hey, Jude, you know. You want to say, I loved your book. And Jude says these wonderful words. The very beginning, he says, this letter is from Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ, a brother of James. That was a very humble thing to say because he was actually the brother of Jesus, the half-brother of Jesus. But he didn't even feel worthy to say that. But then he says these words. He says, I am writing to you who are called to live in the love of God, whose calling is to live inside of God's love. In verse 21, Jude 1:21 says, keep yourself in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know what Jude tells us? He says, your number one job in life is to stay in the embrace of God, to stay aware of constant love of the Father. Because if you do, he gives all these promises. He will keep you from falling. This is the biggest challenge you have. I saw some of my kids, you know, they were taking their little toddlers and to ride on the slide. And when they took little Luke or little Simi, they would put them in their lap. And they would say, stay right here, because we're going to go places you can't go without me. But if you'll stay in my arms, this will be amazing. And every day I hear God saying the same. If you'll just stay in my embrace, if you'll dial up the favor that I feel towards you, and you'll stay close to that, you will go to amazing places that you could have never dreamed. Now, the problem is We have difficulty letting God love us. So many of us have things in our life that block God's love. You think it'd be the easiest thing in the world to keep yourself in the love of God. But there are things, sometimes it's shame. That's what drove Adam and Eve away. Not that they sinned, but they couldn't forgive themselves. And, you know, I was counseling with a couple, and he said about his wife, he says, I tell her that she's beautiful. I tell her she's so lovely. And every time I do, she says, don't say that. It's not true. It's so frustrating because I can't even love her. Why? Because the truth is, whatever value you put on yourself is all that you will allow other people to put on you. And if you put a negative price tag on, you won't believe it when someone else says that you're worth $1 million. Sometimes our shame keeps us running from God. Sometimes it's hurt. Some people had things that happened they blame God for that weren't God's fault. They're like the wounded animal. When you're trying to help the wounded animal, it bites you. Why? Because it confuses you with someone else. I've been around, and I can't believe how many people come to church and they're wounded by church and wounded by Christians. And I've said this so many times, and I'll say it again. I apologize on behalf of all churches and all Christians for all of the horrible things that we have ever done. And people come in, but I say, look, don't let what a church did steal from you who God is. He's not like that. He's your Father. Some people, because of emotions, they don't feel God. And they think that God is equivalent to how they feel. How many know God loves you the same whether you feel like it or don't feel like it? In fact, God's love for you has nothing to do with how you feel. Something else is so true, that God doesn't love you because you're lovable. I know your grandmother told you, and you are, but you know why God loves you? Because he is love. He doesn't love you from your condition, but from his character. He can't not love you because he is love. That's pretty awesome. I'd like to tell the story of the cartoon of Dennis and the Menace, and Joey were at Mrs. Wilson's house, and she gave him a bunch of cookies, and Dennis said to Joey, why does Mrs. Wilson give us cookies? We're not good. And Joey says, Dennis, don't you know, she doesn't give us cookies because we're good. She gives us cookies because she's good. God loves you because he's good. Could I tell you something else? He's better than you think. And if you will change your thinking to who he is, you will not believe the goodness that will come into your life. Some people, it's pride. They don't need God's love. They're their own God, you know. Other people, it's performance. They're driven. I have to earn my approval. And God says, no, it doesn't work that way. God says, please, just let me love you. So I want to tell you just a couple of ways to let God love you. And when you do, you will become his best friend. How do you stay in that constant sense of God's care and love for your life? Number one, receive God's love by faith, trusting in what Christ did. 1 John 4:16, look at this verse. It says, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. Circle the word believed. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God and God in him. Now here's the key word. We not only just know about it, but we believe. Someone said, there are people who will miss heaven by 18 inches. What do they mean by that? 18 inches is the distance from your head to your heart. They'll hear about God's love in their head, but they won't accept it in their heart. The way that you understand love is to believe that God expressed his love in one supreme act, the death of his son, Jesus Christ. In 1 John 4:10, look at this verse. It says, this is what love is. It's not some, you know, gushy, woo, Valentine, yeah, all you need is love, love, love. No, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sin. He says, look, When you think about God's love, don't think about anything but this. There's one thing that proves God's love. It's not your circumstance. It's not because you feel good or bad or got a good raise or didn't get a raise. One thing defines God's love. He sent his only son, Jesus Christ, who would rather come to hell to be with you than to stay in heaven without you. And who stretched out his hands and said, "This is how much I love you." And he died. I love Isaiah 49, 16 says, "See how much I love you. I have engraved you on the palm of my hands." How many know God has your permanent tattoo on the palm of his hands? It's called a nail scar. And when you see Jesus, you're going to look at him and you're going to see forever and ever how much he loves you. And when you believe that, it has the ability to change you from a stranger, a distant person, or even an enemy of God into a friend of God. The moment you receive that into your life. Now, secondly, not only do you receive it, but the second part is you need to reflect on God's love. You need to let the roots go deep. You need to let the reality of God's love sink into you because it's so huge, incredible, that your mind will try to reject it and the devil will be there to tell you it's not true. Look at this verse. This is an amazing verse, Ephesians 3, 17 to 19. I love it. It's a good prayer for us all to pray. It says, "I pray that Christ will be more and more at home in your hearts as you trust in him. May your roots go down deep into the soil of God's marvelous love. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep his love really is. May you experience," and I circled the word experience, "the love of Christ. Though it is so great, you will never fully understand it." I love this. He says, you need to reflect. You need to let your roots, you need to spend time just taking what God says about you and soaking until it breaks through and reprograms how you have thought to think about yourself. He says, God doesn't just want you to hear his love. He wants you to experience it. And the Holy Spirit has come to make this the most dear experience. When the Holy Spirit comes, it changes everything. I remember a man telling me he had been a foster child and he was adopted. He said the man who adopted him was a wonderful man, but he was just kind of formal. And I knew I was his kid, but I never felt like his son. But he said one day when I was 6 years old, we were walking along a path and this man picked me up in his arms and he kissed me and he said, "I love you, son." And he said, that day I went from being a kid to a son. And the Holy Spirit wants to come, even today. If you will ask him, "Holy Spirit, tell me how much Father loves me. My brain can't seem to understand it." So you begin to reflect. And as you do, you'll find that his love can remove every one of those barriers I talked about. He can knock down every wall. First of all, he says, think about how wide the love of God is. How wide is it? It is wide enough to include everyone and to take us from shame to acceptance, from guilt to forgiveness. It encompasses the whole world. Even a thief on the cross there with Jesus, who had done nothing his whole life but sin, in the last minute just said, "Jesus, remember me." And Jesus said, "My love is big enough for that. This day you will be with me in paradise." I don't care where you've been. The Bible says his love is bigger than that. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he removes your transgressions. It's bigger than your worst sin. It's bigger than your biggest mistake. He just tells you, look, in my love, you don't have a past. You only have a future. If I am for you, who can be against you? If Jesus justifies you, he's the only perfect one. No one else is perfect, and he's the only one. But he says, you're not condemned. I forgive you because I love you. If you can hear that, it'll break that wall down. Number two, how long is God's love? It's long enough to last forever. It's unconditional. It's everlasting. Psalm 136:1 says, give thanks to the Lord. He is good. His mercy endures, say it with me, forever. How many know human love runs out? We get tired. I heard a cute story about this elderly couple. They've been married like 60 years, I don't know. And the man couldn't hear very good. But his wife, Harriet, was telling him something like this. He's saying, honey, we've been married 60 years, and that's been hard, and it's been a long time, but I'm sticking to you. He looked at her. He didn't really understand what she said. She said, well, Harriet, I understand, and I'm sick of you too. Aren't you glad that God doesn't get sick of you? His love endures forever. I had people pray a Valentine's prayer, you know, God, give me a boyfriend. And 2 weeks later, they came back, God, deliver me from this boyfriend. You know, I mean, that's just the world. But God's love endures. It never ends. How deep is it? It's deeper than any hurt or pit that you've ever found yourself in. Corrie Ten Boom, who was in the Nazi concentration camp, they asked her, what did you learn in that hellhole? She said, I learned one thing, no matter how deep the pit is, God's love is deeper than that pit. And he never left me. I would never be alone. His love does not simply forgive us, but his love dignifies us. His love changes our identity and puts a whole new price tag on us, puts a sense of value on us that the moment you embrace it, allows you to put your shoulders back, allows you to have a confidence and esteem that's bigger than any rejection you've ever been through. I love 1 John 3:1. It says, what an incredible quality of love the Father has shown to us, that we should be named and called and counted the children of God. And so we are. Romans 8:40 says, so you should not be like cowering, fearful slaves. You should behave instead like God's very own children, adopted into his family, calling him Abba, Father, my dear Father. You see, God's love makes you royalty. It puts upon you the same identity as on Jesus. You become a co-heir. See, God says, in me, you can't be a slave. Slaves have value based on their performance. Sons have value simply based on who they are. I was just reading about Prince Charles, you know, in the UK, and some of his titles. His titles include the Prince of Wales, His Royal Highness, the Duke of Cornwall, the Baron of Renfrew, the Earl of Chester. They got a lot of titles over there. Prince and Great Steward of Scotland, Royal Knight Companion of the Most Notable Order of the Garter. But to his sons, William and Harry, he is simply Dad. When you think of God, you think of the titles of God, Lord God Almighty, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, first and the last, infinite, omnipotent, omniscient, Lord of heaven and Lord of earth. Just remember, to you, his name is Papa. He's Dad. That's what he has chosen for you. This reality will put inside of you a confidence that will drive out fear. I love what it says in 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love. Perfect love drives out fear. To know the love of God is to turn worry into worship in your life. Why? Someone said worry comes because of thinking like an orphan. Worship comes when you think like a daughter. When you think like an orphan, how am I going to get through this day? How am I going to make it? I might blow it. But when you think like God's daughter, of course God's with me. Of course I'll make it. I'm not going to worry about that. How high is his love? It's high enough to keep you safe and secure. It's high enough to watch over your circumstance so that all things you'll know will work for good, so that you will know without a shadow of a doubt, he's not leaving me. I'm going to make it. Even when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, even when I come to that last moment and I face death, I know what it's going to be like. He's going to be there, and I will fear no evil. And I will be wrapped in the arms of my Father forever. It brings this confidence that I can ask God. The Bible says, once you know his love, you become bold. You're not afraid to ask him. He says, the reason I'm your friend is so that you know that you can ask the Father for anything in my name, and I will do it. Well, how should I ask God? I'm so unworthy. No, you don't understand. He has given you the righteousness of his Son. Come boldly to the throne of grace. One thing I love about my kids and my grandkids, they come boldly still. They're adults, but they come boldly to ask. They never come and say, oh, gracious Father, progenitor of the Walker name. They say, hey, Dad, I need some cash. They have no doubt. You can come to God like that. Remember, he's Dad. There's no fear of tomorrow. The confidence of being in the palm of his hand. The Bible calls you the pupil of his eye. I just remember this time I was about 12 again, and me and a friend went hiking in Mount Franklin in El Paso. Here's another mountain story. But anyhow, my friend, he fell in a cactus. We were stuck on the mountain, sort of just lost, and the hours went and became dark, and we were up there. And I was trying to, you know, carry him on my, you know, shoulder, and it was so dark. But what I remember so clearly is that I just stopped, and I prayed a simple prayer. And then this most amazing peace came over me, absolute peace, because this thought came into my mind. My dad will come for me. My dad told me that if I ever get lost, I will come, and I will find you, and I will never leave you. And I just started walking, and it was dark, and all of a sudden, at the bottom of the hill, I see some flashlights. I knew he would come. I found my way to him, and he hugged me and took me home, and woo, there was some trouble then, but that's another story. I forgot to tell him I was going to the mountain, but anyhow, he will come for you. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. So you receive it. You reflect on it. And then you realize it through worship. And just say a few word about worship. Boy, in this week you'll hear, and the teaching is so good. You can listen to it on the app and go to the groups. But he talks about worship. But the one thing I want to say about worship in regard to how it helps you know God loves you, is there is something about putting, when you put words and focus and attention on who God is, not only does it bless God's heart, did you know there's only one thing that God doesn't have that he wants? Only one thing in the whole universe he doesn't have, and he won't take, and that is your love. And when you choose to give it to him, it touches his heart. But in that process, worship does something more. The more you say thank you, the more you say it with your mouth, the bigger it becomes in your heart. Worship takes what is vague and distant in our understanding of God and makes it personal and real. We begin to say it, and all of a sudden, it takes over into our hearts. The only illustration I could think of is when I fell in love with Sharon. I wanted to talk about her all the time. Every time I talked about her, I was more excited about who she was. And then everybody got tired of listening, so I just talked to myself about Sharon. But every time I said, isn't she amazing? Isn't she beautiful? Oh, isn't she gorgeous? She just became bigger in my heart. And I wanted to be with her more. And we had a life of conversations, even before texting. And here's what worship does. Worship seals into you that you've been called to live a whole life with God You see, the time you take, and if I would say one thing, the first characteristic of everyone who's been an intimate of God was they always had an appointment with God first every day. That was their most important thing. Where they just listened to God and they described God and they talked about him and then they let him talk to them. But not so that, boy, I put in my 10 minutes, woo, it's done. But so that the whole day would become doing life with God. People who are friends of God, good morning, Jesus. Hey, let's do life together. Lord, let's have breakfast together. I'm going to drive with you, Jesus. He's going to say, yeah, watch your driving. Let's go to work, Jesus. All of my life, that's how you become a friend. And then the last point, not only do you receive his love, reflect his love, realize his love through worship, but you release his love by joining him in his desire for you to love others. One of the most remarkable ways you become a friend of God is not simply by realizing his love, but by sharing his love and helping others become his friend. The Bible makes it very clear. You cannot love God and hate people. You can't have a deeper love for God. I love you, God. I love you, God. Get out of my life. You know, you cannot do that. Because God is love. I say it this way. God is not a reservoir. He's a river. You can't hog God. God, we are going to have this and nobody else and, you know, and us four and no more, Acts 2:4, and we don't need the world. Let it go to hell. You know, you can't do that. The love of God flows like a river, and every time you join him in expressing his love to someone else, you realize it more yourself. That's why Jesus said, when you get to heaven, I'll say, I was in prison and you visited me. I was hungry and you fed me. I was naked and you clothed me. And we're going to say, when do we do that? He said, when you did this to the least of these, my brethren, you did it for me. You were loving me. I love how Jesus says, these, my brethren. You know what? The person that you think is so annoying, he's Jesus' brother. When you do this for them, see, the highest form of worship is finding the least and treating them as if they were Jesus Christ. And you find Jesus in those people. You don't serve the poor, you serve Jesus. He just happens to show up in the poor. That's where you find him. And each time you do, the sense of his goodness comes deeper. I shared this story in the book I wrote, Kissing the Face of God, but it just reminded me so much. In my last church, there was a dear elderly lady named Marilyn, and she had dementia. She came in a wheelchair. She was in her last days, but her son brought her to church, and she loved Pastor Dale, which was pretty cool. So she would preach to me the whole time I was preaching. That's right, Pastor. Way to go, Pastor. I love you, Pastor. You know, it was my little fan club, And she loved for me to talk to her after the service. I mean, for a long time. She'd hug me. She'd talk to me. Well, one day I had this urgent appointment. I needed to leave fast. And so I played this little trick where at the end of the service, I said, everyone bow your head. And I sort of slowly walked towards the edge of the stage to kind of make this smooth and quick exit. And I kind of led them, God bless you, amen. And as I started, all of a sudden I hear this scream, Pastor Dale! And the whole church heard it. And it was Marilyn. So I kind of put my tail between my legs and walked back over to her. And I reached out my arm. She grabbed me and pulled me. I remember she had a cold that day, and she rubbed her nose on my sleeve and gave me a big kiss. And I love you, Pastor Dale. I love you, Marilyn. And I kissed her. And then we talked until there was no one left in the building. But as I walked away, the power of the Lord's presence, the most intimate sense of God that I could ever describe, came on me. And God said, you know, you said a lot of good words today and you sang some good songs, but nothing ever touched my heart the way that you did when you hugged Marilyn. Now you know how I feel about you. I just cried. I felt God so near me all day, his presence. I said, this is what it means to be a friend of God. Who else, Jesus, can we talk to today? Where else can we go? And the invitation today is as simple as we close. What is the step you need to take to become best friends with God? You know, maybe some of you recognize those barriers. I was hurt. Maybe it's God, I'm gonna let go of that hurt towards people or what I blamed you for. And I'm gonna just dare to believe that you are good. Maybe it's that you really need to start a time where you worship and you just have a quiet time with God each day and you just say, I'm gonna let God become bigger and bigger in my life. But maybe for some of you, today is really about the most important thing of all, and that's beginning that relationship.